This is your girl Yannick Taylor, aka Priestess, hostess of Conversations with the Priestess. Here's a preview of what you may hear on Conversations with the Priestess.
We weren't meant for monogamy, let's be honest. Like, we have needs, let's be real. And communicating that, what you want, what you don't want, what sets up.
Now, this drink is brown. Because I learned something. Since I'm older, I can't do brown liquor anymore. Also, I noticed since I started on hormone replacement therapy, HRT, in 2015, me and certain liquors don't mix well. I don't know whether...
And I recognize that a lot of men love to be dominated by women. And that's because men are seen as these leaders, as this big alpha male dominant thing, dominant being. And... because they're put on this pedestal of being leaders, sometimes they want to be submissive.
Back when I cosplayed a butch queen in South Carolina around 2011, I was on Craigslist. This is when Craigslist was bumping and before they had gotten rid of the personal section.
I hope you enjoyed that preview. Join me on Wednesdays at 9 p.m. for Priestess After Dark. Full video versions of the podcast can be found on patreon.com/CWTPriestess and join me on Fridays at noon for our regular Friday post. Live, love, and be free. Smooches.
Available on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, YouTube, anywhere you download and stream podcasts.
Hello, friends. This is director Michael Antonioni. You know me. I directed last week a movie. That movie is called The Blow Up. Now, I'm here to talk about this podcast. This podcast is about British film. Now, you may ask yourself, why did this Italian guy, who's got a very weird accent, why did this Italian guy direct a movie that was on the British Top 100? Well, I don't know. I'm a weird guy.
Are you from Texas, Mr. Antonioni?
Look, you gotta understand, I'm a man of the world and my accent, it varies across the way. But I was paid a number of dollars as well as a 24-pack of delicious Bud Light to stop by and explain it to you that this podcast is something that everybody's gonna want to listen to. So settle in, kick back, open your own little bottle of Bud Light, and listen to this podcast, and listen to these gentlemen to this week's movie, what they've done to mine. And it made me so happy. Goodbye.
So I'm not sure if that was Michelangelo Antonioni, Yosemite Sam, or a Texan with a giant hat.
Well, I was walking here on the way from across to the north side. As you know, I walk across the bridge, and this guy said he was Antonioni, so I figured it was pretty, it's fine to bring him in.
Yeah. You take a lot of people for their word.
Well, that's the thing. We've had mostly dead people, and I thought, surely this time, we'll have a live guy. Because Antonioni, he's alive, right?
No.
Then I feel like I got conned. And you got conned, the listener, because I got conned. And we're not going to take this standing up, sir. No!
No, we're going to take this sitting down.
That's right, because that's how we do this podcast.
Because I'm not standing up doing a podcast. That's ridiculous.
That's right. I work 8 hours a day. I stand up 8 hours a day. This podcast isn't supposed to be work. This podcast is supposed to be fun, Brendan.
It is fun.
It's very fun.
So much fun. I'm having a lot of fun.
You're having fun. I'm having fun. And you're going to accept the fact that I'm having fun.
What are we doing?
What are we doing here?
I think this is a podcast.
Okay, movies. Right, movies. British movies.
Yes, so this is a podcast called For Screen
and Country.
And I am Brendan.
And I'm Jason.
And on this podcast, we talk about the top 100 British films of all time according to the British Film Institute top 100 list as composed in 1999. Jason, we've covered, I believe, 27 of these movies so far. I could be wrong.
I don't know. I
think that's around what it is. Sure. We're past the quarter mark.
We're definitely on our way to the third.
On our way to the second, fifth, as it were, as we do these in those fifth.
The 4/10th, you might say.
You might say that, but you wouldn't.
No, you would reduce that to 2/5.
You would reduce that as you learned in high school arithmetic.
Did I? I don't know.
I don't know.
A long time ago.
This is off the rails already. But This week, we're talking about a very high film on the list. It's very close to the top. But before we talk about that, Jason, we need to talk about last week. We need to read some comments from the controversial film, Blow Up.
Let's check them out.
First up, Andrew Littlefield. He says, "It's an interesting document of the time, but with the casual sexism of the hero and the oddness of the ending, I can't say I love it."
Is he the guy that wrote that that report that supposedly linked autism to vaccines?
Gonna go ahead.
Is that Wakefield? It might be Wakefield. Never mind. Okay. Sorry, Andrew.
Yeah, he's not the same word as him.
No.
And then real quick, I'll just read this one too. This is real quick. Prefer the film and inspired Blowout. That's from Vincent Franconi.
Franconi. Well, Vinny, we're gonna watch it probably at some point. So we'll let you know.
We'll DM you.
One Nathaniel Tyson says, "I don't know what it is, but Antonioni. I had it last time. Antonioni.
I'm going to stab you in the throat.
I don't know what it is, but Mikey has always left me cold. I don't dig La Ventura either, which I've not seen. So
don't
I can't
lie
comment.
To me. You've seen it.
No, I haven't.
Don't lie to me.
I've seen nothing.
Jason.
I don't watch movies.
Oh, okay. Wait, that makes this podcast take on a whole different meaning.
I've just been making it up as I go along, and I've been lucky.
You're fucking solid.
I know. So our friend, I'm going to presume and call him a friend. I mean,
yes.
I've never met him, but he could be a friend.
Very close friend.
Adam Pellman, not Adam Pally.
No, but close.
But close, Adam Pellman.
So they're probably brothers, because that's how that works, right?
Who's the other guy? Adam Pac-Man Jones? Was he the guy that was in TNA for a while?
Football player?
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
It was. He was in TNA for a while. And he almost never wrestled.
And he was really scared of ghosts?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah.
I think he was always being chased by them.
Yeah.
If y'all see Clyde, you tell him to get the fuck out of here. Anyways, I love it, says Adam Pellman. Although the above comments about casual sexism are spot on. The narrative have always sucked me in, even on repeat viewings, when I know where it's headed or not headed, I suppose. I think the film's detective story serves as a perfect vehicle for Antonioni's preoccupation with existentialism. The search for a solution to the film's central mystery gives the protagonist a sense of meaning. And when that solution proves unattainable, he fades into nothingness. Just like Back to the Future. That idea of the existential detective story is very influential. You could see it at play in Memento, where solving a mystery also gives the protagonist's life a sense of meaning. Plus, it's just fascinating. It's just a fascinating look at the inherent voyeurism of visual media like movies and photography and a true time capsule of 60s swinging London. And it's got the Yardbirds in it, which has to count for something. Yeah, how many movies were the Yardbirds in?
One.
Yeah, this one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is it even British?
The Yardbirds?
No, this movie.
I mean,
you could argue.
Well, I mean,
it's an Italian director, but I guess
it's
yeah,
full of British people and it's set in Britain.
I guess,
and I'm sure the British people paid for it.
I was going to say it's an Italian director, but it is one of his few English language movies.
Is there? I mean, Britain, the spirit of empire, right? People from all over.
Empire Records, yes.
Yes, they come from all over and they submit to the Queen and they contribute.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, to be fair, Italy not a part of the British Empire. But not for what? Not trying.
George Lucas?
I've always been a big fan of colonialism.
Oh, God.
And you'll notice in some of my movies, specifically THX-1138 and Star Wars Return of the Jedi.
Uh-huh. The best one.
I show how colonialism is actually a benefit for the world. You can also see this message deep in the character that Ron Howard plays in American Graffiti. Very much a colonialist at heart.
George, I think I see a movie that needs to be re-edited over there.
Oh, I gotta go. He also farted on the way out.
It's crop dust us. What's with people doing that?
They really don't like us.
Well, I think Robin Shepherd likes us.
Oh, well, what does she have to say about this movie?
Well, she says, "I've watched it a couple times. There are many elements that I enjoy separately, but I never really feel very fulfilled once the film ends."
Yeah, I get you.
And that's kind of like, I think it's like, I didn't feel that this time, because I think normally a movie that kind of ends like that, I'm like, oh, okay, because this feels a lot more deliberate.
Do you know anyone who goes to an art gallery and comes back from the art gallery going, "Holy shit, I want to look at paintings all day. It was fucking amazing." No. you appreciate art. You don't necessarily get excited about it. And I feel like this film is like the equivalent of a painting. And, you know, maybe you're not necessarily going to get excited about it, but you can't help but appreciate the artistry of it. At least to me.
Yeah. I appreciate it, but I think I actually genuinely liked it a lot. Like, what? More than just, like, you know.
Want to get some brewskis on Friday and just get down with some blow-up?
I mean, it's not that kind of movie.
Exactly. That's the only kind of movie that matters.
Michael Bay's blow-up. All right. Holden Martinson, our last comment here is from Holden Martinson. He says, blow-up is one of the great movies about art.
Oh.
Because even the photograph is just about what we see in a photograph. What does it say about the real world? Or what does it say about the world? What about it is true or real? Every piece of art is, in and of itself, a puzzle that we each get to decode. Consider the very obvious on-the-nose brilliant tennis match at the end. If it's real to the mimes, why can't it be real to us? Why can't it change how or what we see around us? Anyway, terrific movie, probably Antonioni's best.
Hey!
Meatballs!
We are going to get a call from the Italian Anti-Defamation League.
Spaghetti!
Stop it.
Pasta linguine.
So we've seen a very wide selection of opinions on this movie, and that's cool.
What I expected.
That's what I like to hear.
It's a very divisive film, I think.
If everybody's just licking the movie's butthole the whole time, it's
really
it's
disturbs
really
me
listening.
That's what you go to for the sucking up thing. Well, moving on from there, Jason, we are going to compare this movie to the AFI list. So, mm-hmm. So Blow Up was number 60 on the BFI.
Mm-hmm.
And number 60 on the AFI is the 1933 Marx Brothers classic Duck Soup.
Which I'm ashamed to say I have not seen.
That is a real shame, because if you like Mel Brooks, you would love Duck Soup.
So you would say Mel Brooks owes a lot to the Marx Brothers.
I would say yes. Any zany hijinks type comedy with like a lot of, you know what? Any spoof comedy, any satire like that, parody, I think owes its whole life to Duck Soup. So because it is kind of a movie, it's only a movie I saw this year, by the way. But even with that being said, I would give it to Duck Soup because I fucking, like, it's great. I love that movie.
And I'm definitely going to have to check it out because I do love Groucho Marx. I've watched a number of episodes of You Bet Your Life, and I watched him on the Dick Cavett Show in his later years.
But by default, you have to give it to Blow Up.
I guess so, yeah.
Not much you can do.
Enjoy that, you Italian meatball. Is he still alive?
Nope. You dried up Italian meatball. So there you have it. BFI, AFI. Do with that what you will.
Done.
But now, Jason, we have to talk about this week's film, and it's going to be Hitchcock. So, of course, that iconic theme can only mean one thing. We're talking about number 4, Jason.
Number four. Right outside the top three. Just standing off to the side of the podium, just weeping silently.
Just going to say, if I was in charge of this list, number 4 would be a British movie about golf.
Oh.
Get it? Do you get my joke? My jab?
The 18 holes?
Four.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. Yeah.
You can get this on another podcast too, folks.
What?
You could get all this on another podcast too. You could get double the dose of Brendan every week.
Every week. Twice a week.
Twice a week.
But yeah, number 4 on the list. One of two Alfred Hitchcock movies on this list. 1935. Jason, this is the oldest movie on this list.
Really?
Yeah. The 39 Steps.
Do you want to know how old this movie is, Brendan? In the opening credits, the credits, because in those days, all the credits were at the front.
All of the credits are opening credits.
But yeah. When you see like the production logo come up and showing like the government logos, that it is a co-production between like the government of the UK and the Irish Free State. That's how old this movie was. Ireland was still known as the Irish Free State, and that changed in, I think, 1937, 1938. It became the Republic of Ireland.
Does that mean that it was Irish free, like you couldn't have an Irish accent in Ireland?
Well, that's right, and that's why everybody's Scottish in this movie, because it's clearly all Irish actors playing them. But we'll talk about that as it comes up.
Well, let's get into it. So, 39 Steps, 1935, starring Robert Donat as Richard Hannay, Madeline Carroll as Pamela, Lucy Mannheim as Annabella the spy, Godfrey Teal as Professor Jordan, John Laurie, who I do want to talk about a little bit, as the crofter,
yes,
also John, Peggy Ashcroft as Margaret the crofter's wife, and of course, last but not least, Wiley Watson as Mr. Memory.
Mr. Memory!
Yeah, so that is also a big part of this movie. So Jason, The 39 Steps, 1935, Alfred Hitchcock.
So what you gotta know right out of the gate is that the main character of this movie, Richard Hay, is a goddamn fellow Canadian.
Oh, Canada.
The home and native land.
Robert Donat. Do we call him Robert Donat? Like, I don't know how to pronounce it.
Our patron acting man. Yeah, Robert Donat plays, I don't know if he, I assume he is hardcore British.
I don't know if he's a Canadian or if
he's just... No, he's not. He clearly is not.
No, I'm not saying the actor. Yeah. I'm saying, I think the character is supposed to be British, but I think he's
Canadian of British parents.
Living in Canada, yeah.
But he is clearly not Canadian because early on, when he asked Mr. Memory a question...
I know what you're going to say.
Do you have a clip?
Well, let's wait till we get to that.
So all right. Well, we'll talk about it when we get to it. So let's talk about this movie. So he's Canadian. He's clearly not Canadian, and we'll mention that as it comes up. So on vacation in London, our boy, our Canuck, Richard Hannay, decides to take in a show at a music hall, which is what you did back in the 30s, because if the movie theater was full, there was nothing else to do. Yeah. It was, again, I'm reiterating a theme that we've had throughout this entire podcast, that in the old days, there was nothing to do.
Nothing to do, and you know what? There's nothing like free air conditioning.
That's right. So they went to this music hall, which I get the feeling this place wasn't air conditioned.
Probably not.
I feel like it was very smoky and very smelly. And a lot of alcohol. I smell a lot of alcohol on the breeze. So he's at this music hall. He's doing some vaudeville shit. There's an orchestra. But the main attraction comes up as he sits down, and it is Mr. Memory.
Mr. Memory.
And again, this is the 30s, so you could do shit that you couldn't get away with today. His whole gimmick, Brendan, is that he has a really, really good memory. Yep. And he has memorized thousands of facts and figures and can repeat them back to anybody that asks.
Well, and now, since we're at this point, do you want to hear a little bit of Mr. Memory?
Please do.
And now I think that our other point will come up about our main character probably not being Canadian.
Yeah, well, we'll get into that.
Let's take a listen here to Mr. Memory in action.
A question, please. Ladies first.
Where's my old man been since last Saturday?
On the moon.
In Quan. Half of his bit.
A serious question, please.
What won the derby in 1921?
Mr. Jack Joel Humorist with Steve Donoghue won a length at the odds of 6-1. Second and third, Craig and Aaron and Lemonora. Am I right, sir?
Right.
What won in 1936?
You come back in 1937 and I'll tell you, sir.
How far is Winnipeg from Montreal?
What won the cup in 1926?
Cup? Waterloo, football or tea, sir?
Football, silly.
What did Crofty win it?
63 BC in the presence of the Emperor Nero.
What causes flipping poultry?
Shh, don't make yourself so common.
Well, our fowls are funny, haven't they?
How many races did Mick the Miller win? How old is my West?
When was Crippen hanged?
Who was the last British heavyweight champion of the world?
Henry VIII.
My old woman.
Bob Fitzsimmons. He defeated Jim Corbett, heavyweight champion of America, at Carson City, Nevada, in October 1897. He was then 34 years of age, sir. Am I right, sir?
How old is my West?
I know, sir, but I never tell a lady's age.
So the clip, I thought it was in there, but it was not. But when we heard Robert Donat ask, how far is Winnipeg from Montreal?
Yeah.
And Mr. Memory gives him the answer in miles.
Yeah, which in the back then, yes, made sense in the 30s.
But Robert Donat does not question that at all.
No, he does not question it. And you'll also notice, too...
what is that in kilometers?
Also, call him Hannay. We're talking about the character, not the actor.
Oh, okay. Well, I think it's Hanny,
whatever.
Actually.
But when he says...
The sun will come out tomorrow.
This Canadian guy. Now, you're listening to two Canadian guys speaking right now. Now, we're from the Maritimes, so we have our own particular accent. But if you listen to this guy, he says, how far is it from Montreal to Winnipeg? Winnipeg. At first, I thought he said Willoughby.
Well, and even Mr. Emery is like, Winnie who, sir?
Winnie who? Winnipeg? Because I've never heard anybody in Canada ever call it Winnipeg.
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 Winnipeg?
Winnipeg.
Who's going to win the pig?
Who's going to win the pig in the bag? The pig in the bag. So yeah, so he's clearly a fake Canadian. So we want to get that out of the way. We were real tired of people playing Canadian face on TV and in movies. And it's insulting.
Hashtag Canadian lives matter.
That's right. Our lives matter somewhat.
Yeah. We're all right.
Mm. Also, crowds real tough in this time, like real heckly. A lot of heckling.
As you heard.
And to be fair, Mr. Memory is not a guy that is, he doesn't seem like, despite the fact that he does this a lot, he doesn't seem to be a guy that like rolls with the punches. Like, he doesn't seem to be real funny.
No.
He knows the facts. That's his thing. He does it. A serious question, please. Like, come on, man. Like, just roll with it. I know it sucks. Hecklers are not fun.
Well, he gets into it a little bit. Like, when they say, like, how old is Mae West? He's like, I know, but I never tell lady's age.
Yeah, he eventually does. But it's like, surely he would be used to that by now. Yeah. I feel like if he's a legit performer. And this is what we're going to spend the next 90 minutes talking about. Mr. Memory's legitimacy.
Nope. This is not Brazil, Jason.
So the crowd, as I said, they're heckly, they're rowdy, they're going on, they're having a good time. But back by the bar, there's a lot of drinking going on. And you can tell there's a lot of drinking going on because there's rough men back there drinking. You can tell they're rough men because they got those flat caps on. That's how you know.
They're manly men.
They're manly men. And one of them gets just a little too rowdy and the security guard comes over and tries to grab him and he tries to scramble away and they get into a bit of a scuffle and then more people get into a bit of a scuffle and then it turns into a damn near Western bar fight before a number of shots ring out. Bang, bang, bang. That's what the shots kind of sounded like.
That would be amazing.
Yes. So that sends everybody into a hoo-ha. They start screaming and running for the doors. Hanny.
Let's just say Richard.
Richard. So Richard is going to run away, but a young lady grabs onto him, or he finds himself attached to a young lady. But they manage to scramble out. And when they're outside, they start having a little chat, and she is very forward and wants to go back to his place.
And we should note, this is where the Hitchcock cameo happens. It's real quick.
Yes, he's standing by the bus or something.
Yeah, they got onto the bus, and just as they're getting onto the bus, Hitchcock and one of the screenwriters walk right by.
Yes. Apparently he's also in the crowd scene later in the movie.
Yeah, I think that one's like a little harder to spot, but yeah.
She seems very forward and won't even tell him her name beyond Smith and wants to go back to his place. And of course, it's 1935 and he's a white man. So he's like, well, shit, I'm getting laid. So they go back to his place and he offers her a drink and all that stuff. But she reveals that her name is Annabelle. Maybe. We don't know.
Annabella.
It could be something else. It doesn't matter. We don't know.
Is it just an Italian name block for you in general?
Yeah, Annabella.
Annabelle Antinoni.
Antinoni. So there she. She reveals that she is a spy, a foreign agent. Actually, is her preferred term, an agent. And she's trying to thwart another spy who is attempting to smuggle some very important air defense information out of the country.
Yes.
She's being chased by assassins. And she tells him that the man behind it is a man who is missing the top of his pinky finger.
The nub.
The nub, you might say. Perhaps some sort of British Yakuza.
Yes. And she calls them the 39 steps.
Bum, bum, bum! But she doesn't expand upon what the 39 steps exactly are.
No, because he's like, what is that, a pub?
Yeah, it does sound like a pub.
Yeah.
I would go to the 39
steps. He's a charming... I want to say right now that the guy, Robert Downey plays Richard, he's very charming.
He's very charming and absolutely. And I feel like this... And we can talk about this when we get into the thing. But this is a very prototypical... Like, this is a very important historical role because this role sets the tone for many of the kind of heroes that we have today.
Yes.
And she leaves, but then comes back later in the evening as he's laying down and walks in the door and immediately keels over... A knife shoved in her back. And guess what, Brendan? She is dead.
That's crazy. Sure?
Yeah,
sure?
No. She's totally
dead.
Did
you check her pulse?
Well, he did, I think, didn't he? Maybe.
I don't know.
I think he just assumed she was dead. Well, she had a knife in her back and she wasn't moving.
It's a movie in 1935. If you like literally got shot in the leg, you were dead.
That's true. Well, yeah.
In movies, do you ever find that like in a lot of those old movies, it's like a shot could be like to like the your ass, and like they'd be like, oh, and they'd be dead instantly.
That actually would be quite, that actually was cutting edge if they got shot anywhere except directly in the chest, because that's where they would always clutch, you know, in the days before squibs.
Clutch the chest and or pearls.
Oh, oh, my pearls. Oh, I'm so offended by this death.
This death is problematic.
So, in Annabelle's hand, though, is Annabella. A map. Annabella. Annabella. In Annabella's hand, there is a map. And on that map is Scotland. And in Scotland, there's a small village whose name I cannot pronounce.
Alt Shelniak or something like that?
Something like that.
Did you notice, too, on the map for Scotland, there's a place called Killin?
Yeah.
I thought that was...
It's pretty cool.
It's interesting.
Killin.
I mean, it's probably a real place, but it's definitely thrown in there to be, a, you know, a subtle little, like, clue.
So, yes, and on this map is the town circled.
Yes.
So, for some reason, he decides, because this girl that died in his house and he almost fucked... He's got to take care of her mission because it's important for the nation.
Well, she also said she was meeting someone there.
And he's not even British. He's Canadian, sure, yeah. But...
She also said she had to meet someone there, right?
Yes.
And you know, there's going to be a twist later, but she said, I'm going to this place in Scotland to meet this person to give them this information about the spies or whatever.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So he decides to do that. But then the phone starts to ring. And earlier, the phone had rang and Annabella... had told him not to answer it because it was probably for her, and he thought that was weird, but he went along with it. But now the phone's ringing, and he looks out the window and sees some men in a phone booth calling, and probably calling him, so he's got to get the fuck out of there. And so he goes downstairs, going to leave, and a milkman is coming in, and he proceeds to have an exchange with the milkman, where he barters away for the milkman's clothes. Oh,
good morning, sir. You're out bright and early this morning.
Could you use a pound note, brother?
What's the catch?
I want to borrow your cap and coat.
Yeah, wait a minute. What's all this? What's the big idea?
I want to make a getaway.
Do a bunk?
Yes.
What have you been up to?
I'll have to trust you. There's been a murder committed up on the first floor.
By you?
No, no. By those two men out there.
I see. Now I suppose they're waiting there as good as gold for a copper to come and arrest them.
It's quite true. Listen. They're spies, foreigners. They've murdered a woman in my flat and... Now they're waiting for me.
Oh, come off it. Funny jokes at 5 o'clock in the morning.
All right, all right. I'll tell you the truth. You married?
Yes, but don't rub it in. What's the idea now?
Well, I'm not, you see. I'm a bachelor.
Oh, are you?
A married woman lives on the first floor.
Does she?
Yeah, and I've just been paying her a call. And now I want to go home.
Well, what's preventing you?
Well, one of those men's her brother, the other's her husband. How do you see?
Why didn't you tell me before, old fella? I only wanted to be told. Trying to keep me with a lot of tales about murders and foreigners.
Yeah,
put this on. Put on my little hat. There you are.
Take the pound.
No, 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 sir. You're welcome to it. You do the same for me one day.
I love that. I love the conceit of him telling him the God's honest truth and him not believing him and then coming up with a very, like... mundane lie.
Yeah.
He's just like, oh, well, why didn't you say? Of course.
Oh, you're having an affair. Well, hell, he was
like, yeah, buddy, I get it. I get it. I got an old battle axe at home. I understand.
I'm married. Don't rub it in. How do you feel about all this anti-marriage stuff, Jason?
I'm very opposed to it, my sweet wife, Katrina, and I would never support this kind of talk.
Oh, boy, here we go. It's Jason's soapbox now. Oh, God. Cut his mic.
So, yeah, so he knows now that he's basically on the run. For a murder he did not commit. Again, this is 1935, and this might sound very cliche, but this is one of those movies that established this cliche.
Yeah, right? It is not cliche in 1935.
No, this is pretty crazy. So he heads for a train, the Flying Scotsman train that is heading up to Scotland.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that makes sense, doesn't it?
Logic checks out.
Sure. So he gets on the train, he sits down with some men who are, which is a funny little scene of... the two salesmen discussing women's underwear because they seem to both sell it, and there being a pastor sitting across from them who becomes rather uncomfortable at the whole situation and eventually leaves.
Uncomfortable, but also, I thought, a little interested.
Yeah, yeah, like, interested, yes, exactly. Like, he's curious, but he's also like, no, this is... I can't, this is... Oh, my position, my job, my me. Like,
women's underwear, oh my God, what if I have an attack?
Oh, lordy. So when the pastor leaves, he gets into the train cabin, I guess you would call it, and sits down, and but then... did the guy show up to the door? Is that what happens? Because he eventually gets up and leaves again. It results in a chase through the train.
No, what happens, so what happens here is once the pastor leaves, Richard is sitting there and hears them, overhears them talking while they're reading the newspaper.
Right.
Because they read about the murder. Actually, right. I do have this one too, this okay. clip too, because I love how Hitchcock is building the tension with them talking about the murder. Is already in the paper, by the way, which is kind of quick, but
yeah, they're real, real good reporters.
But they're already talking about the, I guess they had nothing else to do
15 minutes ago.
they're talking about the murder. And then he's building tension. And then flat, because they get sidetracked by something else in the paper. And I just really like the way they do this scene. So I'll play the clip here.
All right.
Hello. Well, what was it? There's been another woman murdered in the West End flat.
What?
Woman murdered in West End flat.
These sex dramas don't appeal to me. What one?
Bachelor Butt.
Good.
7-4-0.
Oh, not so good.
Portland Mansions, Portland Place.
By the BBC. That's a nice quiet place to put someone to sleep.
Good night, everybody. Good night.
That's a good one. What was she like? One of the usual?
A well-dressed woman of about 35 with a knife in her back. The tenant, Richard Annie, is missing.
You surprise me.
At 7 o'clock this morning, the charwoman Elizabeth Briggs...
Well, if that isn't the blasted limit... What's the matter now? Is there no honesty in this world at all?
I ask you. The new Bodyline rubber panty corset. On sale today. McCutcheon Brothers, Princess Street. Price 17 and 9. Brassiere to match, 4 and 11. Do you get that? The Bodyline. 1 and 3 cheaper than our streamline. No use going to Aberdeen now.
Might I have a look at your paper?
Yeah, so yeah, just them talking, but then, you know, like real people do, like kind of wandering through a conversation.
Yeah, it's great. And like, I don't know if you're familiar with the other Hitchcock movie on this list, The Lady Vanishes.
No.
Okay, but these two characters kind of remind me a little bit. It kind of seemed to me like a precursor to two characters that show up in Lady Vanishes of Charters and Caldecott, mm-hmm. who we'll talk about when we get to that, obviously. But just keep that in mind. Like, their banter is very similar to me.
Yes.
And it's just funny that, like, he cuts off the tension
yeah.
with them, oh, look at this brassiere ad, because the murder's not important to them, right?
Exactly. Their business is what matters to them.
Like, it's only important to us as the viewer.
And to Richard.
And to Richard. But to these characters, they don't care.
It's just something that happened. So he gets uncomfortable and gets up and leaves the cabin and is spotted by some police officers and begins a chase through the train. He eventually ducks into another cabin with a young lady.
Hashtag me too.
Whom we come to know later as Pamela.
Yeah.
And he basically forces himself on her to protect himself from the police, or to hide himself. But she's not having it and alerts them.
Yeah, he kisses her to pretend they're like a couple.
Yeah, yeah. And that happens actually in a lot of movies. But surprisingly, in 1935, she's just like, hey, no, fuck off, guys, he's right here. Like,
yeah.
So he takes off again through the train and they run down. And he basically ducks out a side door and jumps off the train and hides on the 4th Bridge, which is a famous bridge in Scotland.
Still there.
Still there. It was built in the late 1800s. And he hides on one of the pylons. And it is only the efforts of the impatient conductor demanding that they get the train moving, because why the fuck would you stop the train on a bridge, Brendan?
Not a good idea.
And so the police, are scared enough of him that they get the train moving.
You don't know where Sesu Hayakawa is hiding. You That's do right. not want to stop on a bridge.
You will fix this bridge.
And you're canceled, too.
Yeah, I'm canceled again. It's going to be a long life. So he manages to escape and then wanders through the Scottish Highlands until he gets to a nearby village where he meets a poor crofter and his young wife.
Played by John Laurie, who I don't know if you know this show. I figured you might be because it's like a British, it was like a British sitcom for like 10 years, so it seems to be your wheelhouse. He was on a show called Dad's Army.
I'm familiar with that. I have not seen a lot of it, but I am familiar with it.
Can I play the entire clip from Dad's Army? Because this is him, it's about a 2-minute clip, but it's him just telling this like monologue story.
Oh, please do.
And it's great.
All right, so here's a little side venture, folks. Enjoy this clip from the 1970s sitcom Dad's Army.
Yes, with John Laurie, who plays the crofter who Richard is about to meet in this movie.
And reminder, this is not in the 39 Steps.
Nope, but enjoy anyway.
We're anchored off a wee island about 20 miles west of Samoa. And Jethro told me that he'd heard that there was a ruined temple in the center of the island with a huge idol that had a ruby the size of a duck's egg set in its forehead. She was determined to get it. So as soon as it was dark, we rowed ashore, armed to the teeth, and set off through the jungle to find the temple. After About 2 hours, hacking our way through the undergrowth, we came to a clearing. There was the temple, the ruined temple, covered with jungle creepers. The place was deserted. We crept inside, and there it was. A huge idol with a great ruby in its forehead. As the shafts of moonlight struck down through the holes in the roof, it burned like fire. Jethro gave a cry of triumph, jumped up on the idol, and hacked the ruby out of its forehead with his knife. All this time, I could feel eyes, horrible unseen eyes, staring at us. I could stand it no longer. I shouted, "Let's get out!" And we turned to go. And then we saw it. Barring our way in the doorway was the witch doctor. He gave a scream that turned my blood to ice. He shook a bunch of bones in Jethro's face, and he cursed him. After all these years, I can still hear that terrible curse. "Death!" he screamed. "Death! The ruby will bring you death! Death!"
Did the curse come true, Mr. Fraser?
My son is dead. He died. Last year, he was 86.
Goddamn.
See? Long road, but it was worth it.
And the crazy thing about that is that was probably in like the early 70s.
Early 70s.
That was like 35 to 40 years after this movie.
And he looks 70 in this movie.
Yeah, exactly. He looks like he's 75 in this movie. He's very old.
But yeah, I just want to give a little context to John Laurie, because he, like, later in life, a little bit later after this, was kind of a big deal. I mean, he was also in Henry V, which we watched. I don't remember the role he played, but he was in the 1944 nice. Henry V. And he's also going to be in Hamlet as well.
Sweet. So it's nice that we got to listen to him do that, because in this movie he plays a Scottish stereotype.
I mean, yeah.
A Scottish stereotype to the point where, like, basically the if you saw like a Nazi movie and how they portrayed Jews, this is how this Scottish person is portrayed. He is grumpy. He is super cheap. He haggles with him for payment for staying at his house. And, later on, he just goes the full mile.
The full Monty, you might say.
Yes, the full Monty. And he takes off his pants.
This is a very interesting subplot of the movie, because we get this, his wife,
yes,
who clearly was kind of forced to marry a much older man. Because mm-hmm. Richard even asked, "Oh, is that your daughter?" And he says, "That's my wife." So she's clearly forced to marry a much older man for the financial security, I'm guessing.
I assume so. Or because she had no other option.
Yeah, and as soon as Richard is there, she's kind of pining, like, "What's the city like? Like, what's it like out there? Oh, I'd love to be out there." And he says, "Well, we could talk about it over supper." And she's like, "Oh, no, John would never have that. He would never let me talk about that. He doesn't like to think about that stuff." There's a pretty controlling relationship.
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
That he has over her. It's just interesting because it's not anything I've never seen anything quite like this in a Hitchcock movie. Like a very like interesting kind of relationship.
Weird
here.
Little like sub movie almost.
Yeah, it's like this could be its own movie.
Yeah. So they get talking and they have supper and he stays there for the night and he's becoming quite friendly with the wife. And at some point the old crofter John has to go check out the barn to make sure he locked the door. That's what he says.
Yeah.
And so he goes outside and immediately goes around to the window and sees them talking to each other in a very friendly way.
And he thinks that he thinks that they're going to have an affair.
I think he assumes it's already happened.
Yeah. Which is funny because it's another, like, it's a misconception, right? Because really he's just trying to explain to Margaret, I believe is her name, his situation.
Because she had noticed in the newspaper the article about the murder and his name and everything.
And his face.
And his face.
I think they had a picture of him somehow.
Somehow, again, this super good newspaper that comes out 15 minutes after shit happens.
This is a Back to the Future universe.
Yeah, 6 to 12 daily editions delivered.
It's like that Harry Potter newspaper.
Yeah, exactly. It shows him running down the stairs and out. It's just a rolling gif on the front page.
It's that Gary Oldman thing where he's just screaming at whoever's reading.
So he sees them having a friendly conversation, assumes they're going to fuck, and gets real mad. But then the Popo show up. Mm-hmm. And the wife tells John to go out and delay them. And he's like, why would I do that? And Richard has to be like, look, I'll pay you. And he's like, oh, how much? He's like, I got £5. And so he's like, okay. And he pays him. Again, Scottish stereotype. You got to pay the guy.
And John is also like, okay, just go back to bed. I'll take care of it. And Margaret's like, don't trust him. If they give him more money, he's going to reveal where you are.
So she sends him off into the night, but is sure to make him change his coat because his coat is too bright and they'll see him. So she gives him her husband's dark coat.
And at this point, when he's running, I think this is when we see the auto gyro.
Yes.
The little plane.
This is an early, like, prototypical helicopter dealie. This is how important this guy must be to them, that they're willing to haul out this experimental technology in the 30s to go chase him down.
It's almost like a little drone.
Well, no, there's a guy flying it. That's what I mean.
It looks like when I first saw this,
it looks like the fuselage of like a Spitfire with a friggin' propeller on top.
Well, because it looks small, right? Yeah. So when I saw it, I was like, they have fucking drone technology in 1935? What the shit?
But as I understand, autogyros were first invented in the 20s, so this was early in the world of the helicopter, but still, a weird thing to see, so cool that Hitchcock got one for the movie.
And it feels very last-minute added, because it's literally, he looks off to the side, and it doesn't even really look in the right direction, and then they kind of cut to the autogyro flying over. Back, and then that's it.
I mean, that's cool. Maybe there's some stock footage.
Yeah. It was cool. I could tell it was late edition, though.
But he tells her he won't forget her, and he heads off into the night. And they give chase, and they fire a couple shots at him. But he runs across the moors. Days, nights, I don't know how long he was running for. 15 minutes, maybe? Who knows? But he eventually gets to a house. Now, here's an interesting thing. As I understand, in the original novel, mm-hmm. the fact of the map didn't happen.
Right.
So, in the original novel... Richard randomly walks into a house and meets this guy that he's going to meet.
It's very coincidental.
It's very coincidental. Scotland's a big place.
Yeah.
And to randomly walk into the right house. So even Hitchcock was like, that's stupid.
Well, that's what I mean, yeah. Even Hitchcock, as if he's some hack.
He's like, even Hitchcock's like, that is dumb.
Even Hitchcock, the Juve Bowl of his time, was just like, that's stupid. Can you imagine a dumbass like Hitchcock? Yeah.
But anyways, back to the movie. That this idiot made.
Real class A dum-dum.
Real klutz. So he's chased across the moors, as we said, and he goes into this house, which is the house that in the village that he was going to. So it was helpful that he was in the area and he was able to go directly there. So when he gets there, there's this dinner party going on, and he's introduced to the professor, whose name I don't know, but it's not relevant.
Professor Jordan.
I don't know that his name is even said. Is it said?
Yeah, I think so. Okay. I think he says, I'm Professor Jordan.
Professor Jordan. So he starts chatting with Professor Jordan, and it's like this dinner party of all these, I assume, educated people, friends of this professor.
Upper class
sorts, yeah. Drinking and smoking and having a grand old time. And so, of course, they put a drink in his hand, and he lights a cigarette. And
it's 1935. What else are they going
to
do?
That's right. Exactly. There's nothing else to do, especially here in the middle of nowhere in Scotland.
Yeah. No TV.
Yeah. So he's able to speak to the professor and gets to talk to him privately and explains what's going on, that he is, you know, was on the run and that he had been sent here. And he was to meet with the professor because he was taking up Annabelle's mantle. Annabella's mantle,
a movie we will cover on this podcast. Yeah.
And then he explains to him that he was told to look out for the guy who was missing the pinky finger.
But he says the wrong one.
But he says the wrong side.
Yeah, he says, I believe it's this finger or something. He points to like his ring finger or something. And then Professor Jordan is like, do you mean this finger?
And bump, 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 he's the guy.
Professor Jordan is the villain. So that also like leads you to believe that even if Annabella had gone to this place to tell this guy about what was going on, she probably would have got caught.
She probably would
have. Just like he is.
Exactly.
Yeah.
And so they kind of come to a standoff, and he's like, so what are we going to do now? And he's like, well, I'll tell you what, the honorable thing for you to do, being a murderer on the run, would be just be to take this gun I have in my hand and kill yourself. And he's like, oh, I don't think I'm going to do that. He's like, oh, okay, well, I guess I got to kill you. So then he shoots him.
The best part of this is his wife walking in.
Yeah.
And seeing Professor Jordan with the gun in his hand and just casually, is he going to join us for supper? He's like, no, I don't believe so. And she's like, very well. Like she knows exactly what this whole ordeal
is. Exactly. That's just business as usual for her.
Yep.
So he aims the gun at him and pulls off a shot, and Hannay goes down in a heap, and he starts to fade out, and I'm thinking to myself...
Dead!
Wow. I saw this movie before. I didn't realize this happened this early. And then it turns out, no, he's not actually dead. We fade in, and he's in the sheriff's office in the nearby town telling the sheriff about what happened and how the coat that he had been wearing that had been given to him by the young Scottish wife of the crofter had contained a Church of England hymn book, or Church of Scotland, I don't know. It's a hymn book, anyways.
Book of hymns, yeah.
And he had been shot with this tiny pistol. The bullet had been so tiny that it had lodged itself in the book and thus saved his life.
Yep, and we also cut back to the crofter looking for his coat, which is how we sort of set that up.
I think he's specifically looking for the hymn book.
Yeah, he's looking for his hymn book, right? And she says, "Oh, it was in my coat." And she says, "Oh, I gave it to the young man." And then you hear him hit her off screen.
Yeah, off screen. He looks mean and walks over off screen, and you just hear him beating the shit out of her. And it fades back, and that's the last we ever hear of them.
Yeah, but I mean,
what a little mini tragedy playing out.
It is a mini tragedy. It's that story is so well done.
Yeah,
it's just such a small amount of screen time, but it's just really. Cool how they...
Maybe Hitchcock wasn't the dumb idiot we thought he was.
I don't know.
But yeah, and so that... And of course, that completes that Scottish stereotype by turning him into a wife beater as well.
Yep, and he wasn't even wearing a tank top.
Nope. So he explains to the sheriff that he had, played dead and got out of there and come to town and wanted to talk to him. And the sheriff's like, yeah, no problem, I believe you. And I'm sure that the rest of the world will believe you, too.
Oh, laddie, if you tell me, if you're as convincing with the other police as you were with me, you'll be just fine.
You'll be just fine. I don't know why he's Irish, but because they're in Scotland. But then a bunch of police enter the room all of a sudden, and no, the sheriff swerved him. Turns out the sheriff thinks he's a murderer, and he's going to get what's coming to him, and they arrest him. Or they try to arrest him, but he instead decides to bail out the window in classic style. I assume he's the first person to ever bail out of a window in a movie, at least maybe in a talkie.
Probs.
And he takes off down the street, and we get what has to be the first cinematic instance of losing the cops in a parade, which is conveniently going by at night. There's a Shriners parade going on, and he begins marching in it, and they run by. And he's saved. So he ducks out of the parade and into a side building, and walks in, and he gets the... Did you ever see that episode of Seinfeld where George and Jerry get picked up at the airport? They just assume they're some random guy. They just say they're that guy, and it turns out they're going to, a white supremacist... No, you never saw that?
No.
Anyways, that's basically what happens here, although they're not white supremacists. He walks into this group of people, and they assume he's a speaker, so they send him on stage, and he sits down, and he's promptly introduced and brought up to the podium.
Yeah, and this is another... I definitely want to play a little bit of this. So he's brought up to the podium, and he finds out he's at a political town hall meeting.
Yeah.
And he's just kind of spitballing this speech.
Yeah.
It gets them pretty riled up, and if you listen to it, he's kind of explaining his situation.
Yeah.
So let's just take a quick listen here.
And I ask your candidate and all those who love their fellow men to set themselves resolutely to make this world a happier place to live in. A world where no nation plots against nation, where no neighbor plots against neighbor, where there is no persecution or hunting down, where everybody gets a square deal and a sporting chance, and where people try to help and not to hinder. A world from which suspicion and cruelty and fear have been forever banished. That is the sort of world I want. Is that the sort of world you want?
Clearly, he has a career in politics ahead of him. Perhaps he'll serve in the government of William Lyon Mackenzie King during World War II.
That had a real Mr. Smith Goes to Washington vibe for me, too.
Yes, absolutely.
Mr. Hennig.
It's funny they didn't pick out his starkly Canadian accent to show him to be a fraud.
Wait a second, he's not British.
Listen up, guys. I just want to live in a world, you know, where everything's cool.
And cold, like my beer.
Like my beer that I'm drinking now with my toque on my head and my fried bologna in my plate.
I thought you were saying my pants.
My pants. I get my fried bologna in my pants.
I refer to my penis as fried bologna. That's upsetting.
You want to get that looked at.
It's fine.
And not just by anybody. It's by somebody who's qualified.
Oh. All right. Take a look. What do you think?
Oh, I'm not qualified
for
this.
Do you think it's okay? Or?
No. You might want to put a little cream on that.
A little mustard?
Yeah, a little mustard. Mm. Okay. All right. Yeah. But he's recognized by the Lady Pamela, the girl he tried to make out with on the train.
The Lady Pamela?
The Lady Pamela. I'm being very formal.
It sounds like a razor. Get your Lady Pamela.
Well, Lady Pamela shaves her way up the aisle and recognizes him and tells the police, and they see him, and he's apprehended after he gets off stage, and they tell him, look, see, we're going to take you to the police station.
And he says to Pamela, make a call out, let them know what's going
on. Tell the Canadian consulate, get a hold of them, I need help.
And then we kind of discern that these people that want to take him away are not the police.
They're not police, no. And so they drive in they take him, and they insist on taking Pamela too.
Yep.
Even though she doesn't really have anything to do with it other than she alerted them. And so they put them in the car, and they're driving, and they're like, wait, we're not going to the police station. They're like, no, don't worry about it. We're going to another police station that's 40 miles away. So we'll get there in 2 hours. Don't worry about it.
We need you to formally identify the suspect.
Yeah. We just need you to point him out.
Which makes no sense.
Yeah, exactly.
It's a red flag.
But they're authority, so they go along with it. And so as they're driving, they also realize that, no, they're not going to that police station because they know the road to that town, and that's not the road they're taking. And they bring that up, and he's like, the bridge is out. We got a different way.
But thankfully, we are saved.
We are saved.
By a bunch of detectives.
Yes. Hanny does figure out that they must be going back to the professor's house.
Yeah.
But they are saved by a very smart and present flock of sheep.
Or as Hanny calls them, a bunch of detectives.
A bunch of detectives, yes. The car drives up on the road, and there's a bunch of sheep on the road, and the car can't get past. And that is when Hanny and Pamela, kind of against her will, take the opportunity to leave.
Well, they're handcuffed together
at this point. Very old school style. So they get out, they run away, they're chased. And long story short, they hide under a waterfall. Which was clearly a set that had been created, but still looked pretty
cool. I don't know what you're talking about.
and they eventually must have just give up on them because they did get away.
Well, and it's really, foggy, too.
Very foggy, and so that allows them to slip away into the night and find yet another village that is nearby where there is a hotel, and they check into that hotel as a young married couple.
Yes.
And the landlady has suspicions that maybe they aren't married, but they're young and in love, and she likes that.
She wants to protect them.
She wants to protect them, and she says she won't. She'll protect them.
Because at this point, she says she thinks something is up, and they're like, he's like, okay, we're a runaway couple. Don't tell anyone. And she's like, oh, I won't.
Absolutely, and surprising because everybody else has kind of fucked him in this movie that he would trust anybody.
Yeah. And she kind of saves their lives.
She does, absolutely.
Because, I mean, this is right here, right? When the two 39 Steps people show up.
That's a little bit later.
Oh,
We're getting there.
Mean to jump the gun!
So when they're in the room together, Pamela wants to get out of there, and she's going to, scream or yell, and she starts kind of futzing around. And he reaches into his pocket and points a quote-unquote gun into her bag and is like, no, do what I say. And we'll just get through this. And so the landlady comes in, they play it cool, and she... is told to fuck off, basically. They don't tell her to fuck off because she's real nice, but she gets out. And so then they decide they got to get the handcuffs off, but that's a difficult prospect.
She has a nail file, and he says, well, good, in about 10 years we'll have them off.
Yeah, exactly. So they decide to eat some sandwiches and have a nap. And
this is, we get a lot of it's basically a screw-all comedy at this point.
Yeah, at this point, the banter.
And again, 1935... pretty early on screwball, as far as the screwball comedy goes.
Yeah, well, wasn't this right in the heyday of Preston Sturges and guys like that?
Like around the same time, but at the time, fairly new.
Yeah. So anyways, they eventually are tired and they fall asleep on the bed, but Pamela wakes up before him and manages to slip the cuff off. And she's very happy about that. And so she decides she's going to get the fuck out of there, but she hears some voices. And so she goes out onto the balcony, and downstairs, talking to the bartender, are two men. Top men, you might say. That are of the 39 Steps, and she hears them mention that as they're on the phone talking to someone. And as they go about talking, she realizes, oh shit, he's not full of shit. He's not lying about them you know, about this shit that's going on.
I think they're talking to Lord... what the fuck is his name again? Professor Jordan's wife.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, because it's a female they're talking to. So yes. I can only assume, because I don't think the daughter knows anything about it. I think it's just him and the wife.
And so she runs back into the room. And meanwhile, downstairs, they are asking a lot of questions about, you know, if anybody'd come in or whatever. And the dutiful old guy at the bar is answering as he's like pouring a drink. Aye. And but then the wife comes in and starts giving him shit because he's serving what she assumes to be police after they've closed, after hours, which is illegal. Mm-hmm. And she's like, no, you're not getting a drink here. I won't be arrested for this. I won't be fined. Get out. And she shoves them off into the night. And then she turns around with a smile on her face and, oh, you sweet thing. And then kisses her husband. And
which is funny because like, oh, and it's such a contrast to like the Crofter and his wife.
Yeah, exactly.
But it's also funny because she thinks that they're there to kind of bust them as a runaway couple, I think.
Yeah.
And really, it's much worse than that. Yeah. But she kind of stops them for her own reasoning. And then
absolutely.
Yeah.
She's just a sweetheart at heart. So she goes back into the room and decides, you know what, maybe this guy's right. I'll catch some Z's and deal with him in the morning. And so she puts a blanket on him and then goes and lays down on the couch and realizes she's cold. And so steals the blanket back from him and falls asleep. When they get up, she tells him what she heard, and while he's happy that she believes him, he's also really pissed that she didn't wake him up sooner so that they could, you know, get a move on.
Understandable.
So they had said, the men had said something about the London Palladium, so he decides that he's going to head to the Palladium, and he sends her to go to the police in London to tell them about the air defense documents and the 39 steps and all that. So Pamela does that. She goes, informs him about the plot, but doesn't have any evidence, so they're just kind of like...
And they said there's nothing missing. There's nothing been reported missing.
Yeah, there's nothing been reported missing.
They don't know what plans it could be talking about.
Exactly. So she takes them to the Palladium, where Hanny is.
Well, she goes to the Palladium. They follow her.
They follow her.
Yeah.
She kind of takes them there unknowingly, I suppose.
Yeah.
So Hanny goes there, and while he's there, he hears the song, because he had a song stuck in his head throughout the movie. We hadn't mentioned it yet, but he keeps whistling this song, and he can't figure out where he heard it. When he gets there, he hears it again, and he realizes, oh, shit, I heard this at the music hall at the beginning of the movie that I'm in.
Mr.
And who comes out but Mr. fucking Memory, baby.
Yeah. And he realizes, oh, shit, this is where he puts it all together. They're not smuggling the documents out, just taking them.
No.
They're telling the information to Mr. Memory and smuggling him out of the country.
Because he's committed all this with his fantastic memory to his brain.
He also has a tragic biography in this movie.
Oh, absolutely. So
the cops show up.
The cops show up, and Hanny is in there, and he notices in the balcony, too, that the professor is there.
Yeah.
Watching the show. And
he cops, signals Mr. Memory.
Yeah, he gives him, and Mr. Memory gives him a look.
Yeah.
And so the cops see Hanny, and they go to grab him and are pulling him out. And telling them, don't ruin people's entertainment. Don't ruin their evening. Just be cool about this. And he shouts at Mr. Memory, what are the 39 steps?
He says, the 39 steps are an organization of
spies,
blah, blah, blah. And then Professor Jordan shoots him.
Shoots him with his tiny gun from the balcony.
On stage.
Boom. And Mr. Memory goes down. And then the professor decides to pull a John Wilkes Booth and jumps over the balcony down onto the stage. But unlike Booth, who broke his leg and still got away, he's immediately arrested.
Yes. Not killed, surprisingly.
Not killed, no. Just a little shaken up, I imagine. Yeah.
So then we get to the point, we get to the finale here, because Mr. Memory is laying, he's basically having his dying breaths here, because he's been shot, he's going to die.
Yes.
But just before he does that, Richard asks him to tell them the information that, and I want to play that clip here. So Mr. Memory, again, basically on his deathbed, on stage, relaying the information he's been told to smuggle out.
Yep. Mr. Memory, what was the secret formula you were taking out of the country?
Will it be all right me telling you, sir? It was a big job to learn it. The biggest job I ever tackled. And I don't want to throw it all away, sir.
It'll be quite all right.
The first feature of the new engine is its greatly increased ratio of compression, represented by R minus 1 over R to the power of gamma, where R represents the ratio of compression, and gamma, seen in end elevation, the axis of the two lines of cylinder, angle of 65 degrees. Dimensions of cylinders as follows. This device renders the engine completely silent. Am I right, sir?
Quite right, old chap.
Thank you, sir.
So that was the information. It was pretty minimal, but the different compression ratio, but yes.
What's really funny is that actual information is not really that important to us watching.
No.
That's such like a MacGuffin.
I mean,
like,
it's the thing that they didn't really even need to tell us,
yeah,
other than that he had this information.
But what's great is you have the music in the background because they're like, the show must go on, because they're having someone else perform immediately after. Because, like, everybody calm down. Someone just been shot. It's all right. We'll just keep going.
And while this is all going on, we see Pamela and Richard, their hands kind of come together and they hold hands.
Yeah.
And that's where the movie ends.
And Mr. Memory dies.
Mr. Memory dies. They're holding hands. And that's the end.
Boom.
39 steps. You've been stepped up. Stop staring at me and say something.
You're dead to me. So, Jason, now that we've gone through the 39 steps, I want to get into the background of this movie a little bit. And Alfred Hitchcock a little bit.
Yeah, sure.
So, of course, the 39 steps, very, very loosely based on the book, we should say, mm-hmm, because they changed a lot of stuff, by John Buchan. And, of course, the book takes place 1914 in London, just before the outbreak of the First World War. And then the character Richard Henny is actually an expatriate Scot.
Hmm.
And he is visited by a stranger, of course, that knows of a... But this is the difference is he's visited by a stranger who knows of a plot to assassinate the Greek premier. He explains that... this stranger explains that he's faked his death and mentions a group of German spies known as the Black Stone.
Ooh.
So the 39 steps is referring to, like, an actual set of steps somewhere, yeah, in the novel. So basically, and they're set to take British military plans. So that's pretty much the same thing. The stranger is killed, much like how Annabella meets her fate in the film. And Henny sets about to prove his innocence, keep the British plans out of the hands of the Germans. You already mentioned the thing that I was going to say here, but the one thing that Hitchcock improves on was the coincidental meeting he has later with Professor Jordan by having that map earlier in the movie. So that's based on the book. This movie was actually a major attempt. There's a production company, Gaumont British,
mm-hmm,
who Hitchcock was actually doing a lot of movies for at the time. And this was their first major attempt to establish movies in, like, international markets. So the budget for this film was about £60,000,
mm-hmm,
which most of which went to Robert Donat and Madeline Carroll, because they actually had a little bit of box office appeal in America.
Okay.
They were kind of not like, you know, Humphrey Bogart, yeah, later on or anything, but they were names, like, people knew who they were. Hitchcock himself, when we talk about Hitchcock, we have to talk about we can't not talk about women in Hitchcock, yeah, movies, and how his treatment of women has been kind of controversial on both sides, you know.
It's shitty
behind the scenes and sometimes on screen.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, they had this idea of the Hitchcock blonde, and this movie was actually kind of the first movie with that idea, the Hitchcock blonde. Mm-hmm. Of course, Madeline Carroll in this movie as Pamela. There's even a comment, Roger Ebert, when he was talking about this movie, he said, the female characters in his films reflected the same qualities over and over again. They were blonde. They were icy and remote. They were imprisoned in costumes that subtly combined fashion with fetishism.
Hmm.
They mesmerized the men who often had physical or psychological handicaps. Sooner or later, every Hitchcock woman was humiliated. Which, I mean, she does kind of get humiliated in this movie at some point. It's not nearly as bad as, like, you know, the girl gets treated in, like, Marnie or something.
Yeah.
But it's, at this point, how many, okay, if you had to guess, 1935, at this point, how many movies do you think Alfred Hitchcock had directed?
Oh, I don't know, 4 or 5?
18.
Wow.
18 films. And plus more that have been lost to time. Actually, the year before this was The Man Who Knew Too Much,
okay,
with Peter Lorre. His first version of that movie. He was also still doing... So he did movies for Gaumont British for about 5 more years. And actually, before he did Rebecca in 1940. And that actually gave him his only Oscar.
Mm.
So that was, like, he's about fair. Like, he was known in Britain. People in America kind of knew who he was. But this is, like, pre, like, huge fame for,
yeah,
him. One thing I actually learned while doing some research for this movie was that Alfred Hitchcock actually kind of had a lifelong fear of police.
Yes, absolutely. Famously.
Yeah, I'd never heard of that. So there's an incident when he was a child when his dad sent him to the police station with a note. He gave it to the police station and they locked him in a cell for a few minutes. So, like, I don't know what was on the note, but and then they said, "This is what we do to naughty boys." I don't know why I made them Irish. "This is what we do to naughty boys." And it's kind of interesting because after this, he was so scared of doing anything illegal that he didn't want to drive a car in the slight chance that he would get a parking ticket. Like, he was petrified of police. And I think that's why he has so many movies where it's like an accused man, a wrongfully accused man on the run. Because that stems from his own psyche. Like, he's terrified of that.
Yeah, and the police are all, especially in this movie and in other ones too, but they're very set. They very much believe he is a murderer and that he's a bad man and that he needs to go down.
And the only time they really change their minds, I guess, is when the evidence is right in front of them.
Yeah.
And it's really like, it's not even a sense that you don't really get a sense the police like figure it out. It's just that the police are happen to be there when it gets solved.
Exactly.
There's a quote here too. We kind of said this too, but it was said by a lot of people that it's not much of an exaggeration to say that all contemporary escapist entertainment kind of began with this movie.
Yeah, this movie really establishes a formula and a pacing.
Yeah.
That I can't imagine was common in 1935.
It's 86 minutes long.
Yeah.
It moves.
Yeah.
Like, you go from scene to scene to scene to scene. There's no bullshit. Like, it's just cut, 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 cut.
Very, it's like, it's plot. It's like A to B to C to D to E to F. It just goes.
Yeah. Also, I want to note Mr. Memory is based on a real music hall performer named William Bottle.
Huh.
And a lot of people too asked Hitchcock. Well, people were confused as to why, you know, we talked about the end when he says, "Who are the 39 steps?" And Mr. Memory says, "Well," people said, "why would he say that if he was trying to, work for Professor Jordan? Why would he just feel compelled to say that?"
He's a cyborg.
Yeah, you got it.
He's a robot. Sorry, guys.
Hitchcock said, the whole idea is that the man is doomed by his sense of duty. Mr. Memory knows what the 39 steps are, and when he is asked the question, he is compelled to give the answer. So it's like he's kind of like a soldier. Like, if you ask me, I have to answer.
That's like his character. That's his kayfabe. He has to answer.
He's totally in character the whole time.
I think Daniel Day-Lewis might have played Mr. Memory now that I think about it. Oh, shit.
Daniel Day-Lewis is 9,000 years old.
He's a vampire, an acting vampire.
Let's dive in a little bit to the movie. I noticed this movie opens with kind of a Hitchcock staple, especially in his early movies. He likes to open with scenes that will seem innocuous at the time.
Mm.
Like opening with this Mr. Memory scene.
Yeah.
You watch the movie for another hour. You're like, I guess that was just a way to start us off. Like, you don't think it has anything to do with the plot. But he does that a lot. And he generally uses these like unimportant quote unquote scenes in like a comedic way.
Mm.
And of course, another Hitchcock staple, Innocent Man on the Run. Yeah. This is like the first, I think, the first major one. I think The Man Who Knew Too Much. No, that wasn't The Man on the Run. I think The Lodger was like 1927. Yeah. That's like a really early Hitchcock. Kind of the same thing, but he wasn't so much on the run. It was just a wrongfully accused dude.
And then later in his career, I mean, North by Northwest, and I think there might have been one other too.
I mean, I think there's elements of that in almost everything. Like even Vertigo, mm-hmm. I think there's elements of that in. I don't know.
I don't. I haven't watched Jimmy Stewart's kind of mentally on the run in Rear Window.
Yeah, it's another one I haven't seen.
It's a great movie.
I
haven't seen a lot of Hitchcock movies, but I've seen Rear Window, and that is a good one. And Lifeboat, too. And The 39 Steps.
There's some cheeky little dialogue here. There's a thing here with... we talked about early in the movie when Annabella wants to go home with Richard.
Mm-hmm.
Did you notice what he says? The first thing he says to her, she says, "I want to go to your place." And he says, "Well, it's your funeral." Literally what happens, if you come home with me, it will be your funeral.
It turns out that he was righter than he could ever have imagined.
And then that scene like that with Richard and Annabella, there's such the tension is so good. Like the way he creates the tension, because they're in the dark room and she's kind of scampering around. She says, "Don't turn on the lights, wait till I'm against the wall. Okay, you can turn on the lights, toss me that footstool." Like, there's no music.
Yeah.
Most of the movie, there's no music. So it's all about like the placement of the actors and like the lighting.
Well, it's like when you first watch that movie and you see this happen, you think, what is wrong with this crazy woman? And then, of course, looking back, it's like, no, she's just taking precautions. She's on the fucking run, man.
Exactly. Oh, I think I got a vibe here that Don't Look Now might have lifted something from this.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's a real quick scene, but when he goes on to the train and he boards it or whatever, they cut back quickly to a woman investigating the room he was in and seeing the body. Like, and we don't see the body. And screaming, but her scream is just the train whistle.
Turns into the train whistle, yeah.
It's right from Don't Look Now when Julie Christie has that moment.
Yeah.
When she screams in the opening scene. And it turns into, like, the church bells.
And actually, you see that similar kind of cut in Once Upon a Time in the West, early in the movie, when they're shooting, when they go to shoot the kid, and it just cuts to the train whistle.
I think it starts here, because it's a thing that we've seen so many times.
Well,
but just, like, even the fact that we've already seen it on this list is crazy enough, right?
Well, you know what they say, if you're going to steal from a dumb idiot.
You vape all this time.
That's right.
Another cool little thing, just a quick thing, but when he's in the crofter's house and he's looking at the article, I don't know if you noticed, but the way the candle lights it looks like there's like a little noose around.
I did not notice that.
Yeah.
Fancy. Mr. Detail over here.
Pretty good for a dumbass. Yeah,
that's right. A moron.
Oh, and another thing, too, I think gets used a lot is this idea of Professor Jordan being the villain, because it's like this thing where he's this exquisite gentleman and he has this sort of because I don't think anybody at that party is necessarily a villain. They're just like upper class rich people. And how many times have you seen that in a movie where the villain is like this upper class dude who nobody suspects because everyone loves him, everyone's a friend of his? That's like every Bond movie.
And despite the fact that he shoots two people, he never really has a moment of like going nuts.
Yeah, but isn't that
other
like
than jumping over the balcony, but he doesn't make a fuss about it.
That's like a lot of Bond movies, yeah, right? Like a lot of the villains in those movies, outside of maybe Blofeld, are just like these upper class people. Even Goldfinger, like, he has a lot of like powerful friends, and not everyone knows what he's up to.
Oh yeah, the spy genre owes a lot to this film.
Do you think it's interesting that we did this movie the week after we did Blow Up, which was a kind of an anti-spy movie?
Well, which was a movie that I expected to be more like this movie, and it wasn't at all.
Right. It's kind of interesting that this is kind of the real version.
Yeah, the movie we expected happened this week.
Yes. You are correct.
I am correct. I also wanted to point out, it's just special props to the waiters on the train when they're chasing Richard through the dining car and the police come bounding through, and that waiter manages to not knock over a single thing off his tray as they like push past him on the train. So, I mean, it's understandable. You work on a train, you got to be good about holding your dishes, but good for him. So, salute to that man who's probably been dead for 70 years.
If your great granddaughter is listening, I hope you know that your great grandfather was
a real champ.
Champion of champions. That was probably like take 82, let's be real. Actually, so we talked a little bit about Richard and Pamela as like this, they're kind of bickering for a lot of the movie.
Yeah.
And I want to play another clip of them. This is when he just kind of settles in because he's tired of arguing it. And he's like, oh, yes. He's finally just like, yeah, I've been murdering people for a long time. Like he's kind of given up on trying to convince her, right?
Yeah.
And I got kind of a Cary Grant, Katharine Hepburn vibe from this little like scene. So I just want to play a little this scene here.
Do you know when I last slept in a bed? Saturday night, whenever that was. Then I only got a couple of hours.
What made you wake so soon? Dreams?
What do you mean, dreams?
I've always been told murderers have terrible dreams.
Oh, but only at first. Got over that long time ago. When I first took to crime, I was quite squeamish about it. I was a most sensitive child.
You surprise me.
Used to wake up in the middle of the night screaming, thinking the police were after me, but one gets hardened.
How did you start?
Oh, quite a small way, like most of us. Pilfering pennies from other children's lockers at school, and a little pocket picking, then a spot of car pinching, and smash and grab, and so on to plain burglary. Killed my first man when I was 19. And in years to come, you'll be able to take your grandchildren to Madame Tussaud's and point me out.
Which section?
Oh, it's early to say. I'm still young. But I'll be there all right in one department or another. Yes, you'll point me out and say, Chicks, if I were to tell you how matey I once was with that gentleman in Bishop's Manor.
I don't know if it's a function of the accent that he's speaking in, or if it maybe is a direct reference to that performance, but the way he tells that story sounds very much like when Mr. Humphreys on Are You Being Served, who's the kind of the second in command of the men's department and very campily gay, tells an offhanded story. Just the way, like, the sound of the tones and how he kind of goes up at the end of his sentences sounds very much like Mr. Humphreys. And I don't know, it just reminded me of that. And I don't know if John Inman saw the 39 steps and, I mean, and thought sure that, or if it was literally just a coincidence or maybe a function of the, maybe a similar accent, but that's really cool. Unfortunately, John Inman is also dead, and I can't ask him.
I believe you can, because the mausoleum is right over there.
Well, yes, but they don't tend to let us interact with them. They just tend to come in most of the time.
Hopefully
occasionally.
Hopefully he's in a movie we cover.
Well, that would be lovely. I would love to see him in something.
Another thing that pops up in other movies, there's literally almost this exact line. It's like, out of all the people in the world, I gotta be chained to you.
Yeah.
Like, that's a thing that, how many times have you heard that?
All the gin joints in all the world, yeah. She had to walk into mine.
Exactly. And during that whole scene that I just played a clip of there too, Madeline Carroll's doing some great like facial acting, like facial mannerisms. She's kind of, you disgust me. She's doing some slight, just like a slight smile, but also she's trying to stifle it at the same time while he's making jokes. So it's showing her kind of warming up to him
Warming up to him, but she doesn't want to. She doesn't want to know.
Yeah. And even like at the end of that clip, we cut it off, but she says... She kind of laughs and he says, "What is it?" And she's like, "Nothing, you're hurting my wrist." Like, she tries to, like, you know, shut that down.
I do appreciate in this movie how did they, at the end of the movie, they clearly have a little bit of affection for each other, but it wasn't like that this movie then thrust them immediately into a relationship, as so often happens in movies. Like, they go through a trauma together and it's like, "Hey, I guess we should be in a couple now."
I heard this on another podcast one time, but like, marriage in these old movies is so, like, quick, and people get divorced so quick,
yeah,
and it's just handled so loosely. And yeah, that is impressive that they, at the end of the movie, they weren't getting married.
Well, when it comes down to it, Brendan, you got to cram it into 90 minutes to 2 hours.
Yeah,
that's why it happened so fast. If only for those poor women, it was this easy back in those days.
So the last thing I want to mention, and then the last thing on my notes anyway, the last Hitchcock staple that I kind of noted was, I don't know if you noticed this, but a lot of his movies, he likes to set up the final scene at like a well-known landmark. There's the Man Who Knew Too Much remake that's at that big Carnegie Hall, I think, or something like that.
Oh, in North by Northwest at the what do you call it, Mount Rushmore?
Yeah. There's all, like, and Hitchcock's always said, like, he wants to create a familiarity because it helps people to kind of place themselves in the scene and kind of, like, it creates even more tension because you know what's kind of the geography of the building,
yeah,
or at least, like, what it looks like. So, and we get that here. That music hall is a real music hall that he was filming
at. The Palladium, I believe, is very famous.
The London Palladium, yeah. That's all I have. If you have any more things you want to mention, go right ahead.
I have at least one thing I need to say.
Okay. The bird is the word.
No, there's one line that made me laugh because I don't understand it totally, but it just was kind of funny at how offhanded it was said. Is she, when they were in the room, she was like complaining that he was going to hurt her or something, and he goes, "No, no one's going to hurt you. This is Armistice Day, which, like, Remembrance Day, I guess. But what a weird thing to say! Like, that's the one day that women don't get raped, is on Armistice Day.
Wow, isn't an armistice like an agreement not to, like?
Well, it's an agreement to end war.
Yeah.
Before a peace treaty, but to end, like, immediate hostilities.
I'm guessing that's the joke, just, yeah, like...
I guess so. No, it's Armistice Day.
No, yeah, peace.
Oh, I see. Yeah, it's funny when jokes make sense and they're explained to me.
All right, Mike Bullard.
Look, I'm doing my Mike Bullard right now, but you, the listener, can't see it.
And no one listening knows who Mike Bullard is.
You should. He was great. I love him. I saw Mike Bullard live in Halifax, and he was a delight.
What, did he just do crowd work the whole time?
Yeah, no, he literally did. He said it. It was funny because he always said this, and it was always true. He had 3 written jokes in his act, and everything else was crowd work, and that's exactly what happened, and it was a delight.
39 Steps. Let's talk about the critique of this movie, because Jason, nothing.
No.
No Oscars.
No.
No Golden Globes.
Weird.
BAFTAs
weren't... Wait, 1935. I guess the Oscars were around.
BAFTAs weren't really a thing at the time.
No.
Not for several years. So that was out of the question. But I will say that contemporary reviews at the time were very positive. For example, the New York Times said, if the work has any single rival as the most original, literate, and entertaining melodrama of 1935, then it must be The Man Who Knew Too Much, which is also out of Mr. Hitchcock's workshop.
Mm-hmm.
A master of shock and suspense, of cold horror, and slyly incongruous wit, he uses the camera the way a painter uses his brush, stylizing a story and giving it values which the scenarists could hardly have suspected. Variety said international spy stories are most always good, and this is one of the best, smartly cut with sufficient comedy relief. First class entertainment, said someone else. The New Yorker, speed, suspense, and surprises all combined to make 39 Steps one of those agreeable thrillers that can beguile the idle hour. Mystery experts will enjoy the whole thing. This movie is also Orson Welles' favorite Hitchcock movie.
Oh, wow.
One of his favorite movies of all time, to which the quote from him is just like, oh my God, what a masterpiece. He loves this movie. So much so... Got something here for you, uh-huh. Jason. So much so that the Mercury Theater... adapted the book 39 Steps into a radio play, and I've got a little clip for that.
Oh yes, let's hear it.
And you'll notice it's very different because this is closer to the book than the movie.
On the 15th of July, there will be others in London. I don't know who. He had a name for them. He called them the Black Stone. But somehow this information... Those secrets about our fleet destined for France will be diverted into their hands on that day, July 15th, and will be used, remember, a week or two later against England by our deadly foe with great guns and swift torpedoes, suddenly in the darkness of a summer night. I know you don't believe this. I didn't when he told it. I do now.
Love hearing Orson Welles' voice, though.
Yeah, so he, of course, starred in it because he's Orson Welles and it's his fucking theater. So. Yeah. But it's just, I thought that was interesting.
That is really cool.
It was in 1939, so it was only 4 years after this came out.
Same year, I believe. Was that the same year as the War of the Worlds, maybe? Or was that earlier?
I'm not sure. I know it was... 2 years before Citizen Kane.
That's true.
So that's pre-Citizen Kane Orson Welles.
Yeah, well, when Orson Welles was like, you know, cutting his teeth in radio and making a name for himself.
Yeah. So, 39 Steps. What do you think?
Great fucking movie, Brendan.
Amazing. Great. Innovative.
Innovative and holds up. Like, it's still really entertaining to watch.
You can't wipe this movie from history because it... is the fabric of so many
a
movies.
Blueprint, you might say, for an entire genre.
Like that quote said, every fucking escapist, like high tension suspense thriller, man on the run, whatever, all comes from this.
It laid down the pipe.
Like, I mean, you can maybe say there have been elements of this before this movie, but I don't think anything nearly as successful.
Well, I can't think of any movie I've seen that old. And to be fair, I haven't seen a whole lot of movies from the 30s, but. Like it just is such an interesting and fast-paced movie for its time and entertaining. Like I say, entertaining as hell. Everybody's good in the movie, and the dialogue is fun and witty and you know, must have been very different than a lot of the other stuff that was around at that period.
Well, and I'll let you know, too, I actually was embarking on a little bit of a project a couple years ago where I was trying to watch every Hitchcock movie.
Yeah.
I got up to... I finished Rebecca, so I did all of his British stuff.
Yeah.
And I can tell you that... not all of his British stuff is great.
Yeah.
he does a lot of like weird things, weird movies thrown in there. Like he did a movie about Johann, I don't know,
Waltzes. Sebastian Bach?
He did a movie called Waltzes with Vienna.
Okay.
And it was strange.
A composer.
Yeah. It was like a musical. It was really weird. So, but like that having been said, this really sticks out if you watch his British films. Like this is The Man Who Knew Too Much. Probably The Lodger, and of course, the movie we're going to talk about some other time, The Lady Vanishes, definitely stick out major. And then once he gets to his American film, it's just like hit until the very end. With
family
like,
plots. Family plots.
Yeah, family plot, maybe not. Family plots. Plot. Is probably.
Plots. It's a plot.
But he had, like, you know, he had a couple of like that Paul Newman movie that he did that wasn't that well received, but I guess he hated Paul Newman.
No.
But anyway, so like a couple of misses along the way, but one of the most consistently solid directors and always reinventing himself, like always challenging himself. Like Psycho was like the biggest.
Mm-hmm.
People say Psycho is like, you know, a lot of people say it's one of the greatest films of all time, probably best Hitchcock movie, but it's so different from every other Hitchcock movie. So, I mean, this is a guy who.
And as at least as influential as 39 Steps, if not more.
Yeah,
certainly more people remember Psycho than the 39 Steps.
But, oh yeah,
I mean Psycho laid down the pattern for much of the horror genre.
I mean, you say Hitchcock, I guarantee you somebody's going to say Psycho.
Yeah, that's what people. That is immediately what comes to mind.
Yeah, Psycho, and maybe like second would be like Vertigo or something.
Yeah,
like it's or Rear Window.
Rear Window. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, this movie is groundbreaking.
Absolutely.
At number four, I mean, I understand why it's there because
it makes total sense.
Super influential. Yeah. Anything else you want to say about that movie?
Go watch this movie. Criterion has a disc of it. Check it out.
Very easy to find. It's out there. So now, Jason, it's time to come.
It's Vader time.
It's Vader time, which means it is time to roll.
Put on our dirty wrestling gear that we don't wash because it's bad luck.
Is that a Vader thing?
Yeah, that was Leon White's, that was his superstition. He wouldn't wash his wrestling gear because he thought it was bad luck. And of course, then the question becomes, well, it's not a competition, so why do you need luck?
That is gross. Wait, ever? He never washed it?
Apparently, not very often, as I understand from people who have wrestled with him.
All right, well.
Maybe Stan Hansen's nose is as bad as his eyes.
I can only hope. So what we're going to do now is I'm going to roll the dice, because it's my turn, Jason.
That's right, it is.
And the number that I get on the dice will correspond with the number on the BFI Top 100 list that we will cover next week. This is a very tense moment, full of high drama and suspense. Let's see what we get. Let's see if we get something different, something similar, something long, something short.
Something funny, something new, sad.
Something old.
Something borrowed, something blue.
That's right. Four weddings and a funeral. We'll do it again. All right, here we go. So I'm going to roll the 10s D first.
The D10.
The D10. Yeah, whatever. Just to up the tension. Ready?
All right, here we go. 40.
Okay, 40-something. 40-something. What are we going to get here? 47.
47? That would be 1959's I'm All Right, Jack, directed by John Bolting.
No idea.
No, nothing about it.
Nothing at all. All right, well, you know what? It's been a while since we've done a movie that we were kind of like dumbfounded by, so let's hop into it.
Yeah, sure,
so,
why not?
I'm All Right, Jack, number 47 on the BFI Top 100.
I'm calling it. I bet you it's a kitchen sink.
I think it might be a comedy.
That's good, too.
I think so. Because I think I remember seeing the poster, and the poster looked pretty funny.
Okay.
So we'll see. Watch it be like about like a horrible like rape revenge movie or something. It's not a comedy at all.
1959.
Yeah. Is it 1959?
Yeah.
Okay. You can find that movie, check it out, and then listen to us talk about it and spoil it if you haven't watched it.
That's right.
But until then, Jason, you can find us on the social medias. Just look on Facebook, search for us. We're under For Screen and Country. Of course, it'd be weird if we were under something else on Facebook.
It would be, wouldn't it?
You can find us on Twitter at BFI_pod. You can find Jason on Twitter
at Jason D. McLeod. That's MacLeod.
And I mean, speaking of what we were just talking about earlier, he usually just talks about I Spit on Your Grave and its various remakes. In detail.
Also constant discussion of the old PC game, I Have No Mouth and I Must Scream.
Sure. Don't know what that is, but let's do that. Let's go with it. But also, now is the time to say to you...
To me.
And again, if anyone else is listening, this is between Jason and I.
So stay out of it.
It's really rude to interrupt. So if
keep it to yourselves.
Yeah.
Cram it.
Hey, Craig, don't need the comments right now.
Danny? Houston?
Danny and Houston?
Danny and Houston? Houston? No, Danny and Houston.
Oh, okay.
Their parents were big Danny Houston fans.
Okay. Who's a big Danny Houston fan?
I don't know. Their parents.
Angie? Calm down. So, Jason.
Brendan.
I'm putting on my blinders so I can look right at you. I have one thing to say to you.
Say it to me, Brendan.
God save the queen.
God save the screen.
And for Screen and Country, I'm Brendan.
And I'm Jason. What are the 39 steps?
An organization of spies! and it's going to be Hitchcock. That's a different movie.
Oh. I mean, it was a Hitchcock movie, though, right?
No, Friday the 13th?
Yeah. Alfred Hitchcock's Friday the 13th.
Ladies and gentlemen, this week's discussion.
It's time, let's check our cue, baby. Pair it with a couple brews, baby. We love good movies. We love the bad ones, too. So we watch them all and pass their lessons on to you. Oh, yeah. Bana, 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 everything I learned from movies helps to make life a little bit groovy. We're the one last plot holes of gratuitous movies. It's time to get busy with your friend Steven Izzy.
At EILFM.podbean.com.
Hi, everyone. I'm Ashley.
And I'm Justine.
And we make up the Cutaways podcast. We're watching the good, the bad, and the essentials of the romantic comedy genre.
So far, we've fallen in love with Cary Grant, met up with our terrible friend, Pal Joey, and had the desire to run our fingers through Patrick Dempsey's hair.
Join our slumber party for your ears every other week. Brought to you in stereo from our blanket fort in Hollywood, California.
You can find and subscribe to us on Apple Podcasts, Stitcher, or your favorite podcatcher. Our digital blanket fort can be found at thecutaways.com.
If you are the social butterfly types, you can also find us on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram as @cutawayspodcast.
Bye!
The great visionary leader of India, Mahatma Gandhi, said, "It is health that is real wealth, and not pieces of gold and silver." Listen to the Healthy Grocer radio show on your favorite podcast platform. We know that health is our greatest wealth, and we will be discussing all aspects of natural healing. Explore everything from supplements, superfoods, and healthy lifestyle choices to help conquer stress and boost productivity. Top industry experts and natural health professionals join us for a deep dive into our healing journey. You can find the Healthy Grocer radio show on demand every day, wherever you listen to your favorite podcasts. And remember, health is your greatest wealth.